I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane, broadcasting from the Marcus Garvey House here in North Minneapolis. And you know, it's all about the neighborhood. This is a conversation about how we build our community, our neighborhood, house by house, family by family. We're focusing on business creation, business development, economic development, and culture. It's a wonderful conversation, a robust conversation. One of the guides for this conversation is my brother, who takes us on a musical journey, Wayne McFarlane and jazz. Check him out.
Be up, be down, be clean, be messy, be here, be wherever, be sour, be sweet, be the rhythm, be the beat, be funny, be serious, be in, be out. Wherever you're at in life, be you. With Medica, you belong.
Programming is supported by UCare, where health coverage, personal service, and quality care come together to put members first. Learn more at ucare.org. UCare. Healthcare that starts with you.
I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane, broadcasting from the Marcus Garvey House in North Minneapolis. Today's program focuses on business development, business opportunity, entrepreneurship, creating both opportunity, access, and environments that grow businesses in our community. My guests today are two gentlemen who work in that space to help bring new businesses online. Silas Houston is the CEO of the Metro Area Small Contractors Alliance, a unique model for creating effective business collaboration and contract opportunities for contractors. Phillip Porter is the loan officer and business advisor for NDC, its Neighborhood Development Center in St. Paul, an organization that over 20 years now has been providing both loans and technical assistance to community businesses with a strong emphasis in serving African American Black community businesses. Gentlemen, thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Silas, let me start with you. You and I talk all the time about barriers to business for Black people, but we don't talk about it in a way that is gloom and doom or moaning and crying. We talk about the resilience and the capacity of our people to understand the market and to drive ideas, innovation, and collaboration that both brings product and services to the market and creates profit and growth in our community. That's the proposition for MASCA, I believe. Tell me about the organization.
Well, I would agree with all of what you said, and we, MASCA really is the result of a group of African Americans who got together and decided that we wanted to do business with each other. And we didn't really know what. We met for a while. We were, you know, we did business in our separate silos of things that we did, but we saw a space where our collective skill set could maybe go to the marketplace together. And so when the city of St. Paul back in 2008 got hit with their voluntary compliance agreement, which wasn't really voluntary, but it changes. We saw that in its draft form. And then as a group decided, hey, this is gonna change things, what could it mean? And so for us, it was certainly about self-determination, about coming up with our own solutions. And so from there, we started on a journey that brought us here 6 years later, where we did research into what was going on in the construction market. We talked to over 150 small contractors. We talked to 36 general contractors. We talked to municipalities. We talked to politicians. We talked to all of those different people to find out what was happening and why wasn't more development within really African Americans, but minorities overall was the issue. But being African American, it made that a primary issue for us. And really,
what assumptions did you have going into doing this research? What were you looking to find? What did you expect you were going to find?
You know, that's interesting. We certainly went into it hoping to be true analysts and having no assumptions, but quickly found out that we really did have some because we started being surprised by what we found, which said we had some assumptions. And those assumptions really was around believing that the issues emanated strictly from discrimination, strictly from, you know, exclusionary practices, and found that that was certainly a part of it, but it didn't tell the whole story. There were a whole host of other things, both obvious and not so obvious, that really combined to create an environment that made it very difficult for development to take place. And we use the word development as different from giving somebody a part of a project, or they get a job, or they do some work. Development means that when I see you next year, you're better off than you were last year, and you're bigger and you're more developed. We saw very little development in our research, although there was a lot of people doing business. And so our biggest assumption going in was is that they're the problem, if you will, and we found that.
Okay, so you all, and you found the problem, but the finding supported your thought that you could do things together to bring a sort of conscious collective to market better than anyone could come to market individually. Is that correct?
And that's really what we found. That was the critical thing that we found, that economy of scale, as we think of it, is that you're too small to get all of what you need, mm-hmm. and nobody's making allowances for you not having them. And so we believe that working collectively, working together in a shared resource model, but we also believe and found that within our community is all the skill sets necessary for us to be successful, right? We found the people with construction background, finance background, you know, process background, risk management background, all of those people operating, doing business, working for other people, but living right in our community. And so that's what we tapped into to design our own model. And when we looked at that model, it became clear that there were other people out there doing things to try to make it work, but they were all separate. And so folks like the Neighborhood Development Center, who I worked for back in the late 90s, and now partnering with now, we saw that they were there attempting to help these contractors, but operating in that silo, they were more of a burden to the contractors than they were being helped, because they got paperwork and things that they need that's required, that makes sense, that these guys know nothing about individually, don't have the time, energy, know-how to be able to provide. So they're saying, give me the application and I'll help you. And they're saying, well, I need help to get the application. And so we really found that by coming in and organizing ourselves, agreeing to work together originally, investing in ourselves, that we can overcome some of those barriers so that we can begin to see development take place.
And the principle of self-determination.
And the principle is most definitely self-determination. But self-determination means self-investment. And right. So we're a for-profit entity. Our contractors own a portion of us. And as we grow and our value grows, they will share in that value. Our equity will grow. But they have to own their solution. And that's where MASC is different than other solutions, in that we are directed and work directly for the contractors that we're giving service to. They are our bosses. We work at their, and so when we look for solutions, mm-hmm. those solutions have to be first and foremost working for them, mm-hmm. but also working for the partners who are part of this whole deal. If it works for us but doesn't work for NDC, mm-hmm. then it's going to be difficult for them to continue to work and support us. So those are really the kind of things that we really found.
So you work on behalf of the contractors, the small contractors. You engage your partners. What's MASC's relationship with the customer?
So we
and who's the customer? Define that process.
The customer, really, the customer for MASC and for the contractors is very similar, right? In a lot of cases, our ultimate customer is a municipality, right? The state of Minnesota, MnDOT, the city of Minneapolis, you know, the Met Council, people like that. Those are the really the top of the line. That's who we're working for. They're providing the money there. And then you get below that, you have developers who have projects that they're doing and you work for them. Then you have general contractors that are there. Then you have large subs that may be a large painting sub. And for a small guy like us, we could end up working for any number of those folks.
Anywhere
on that spectrum. Mm-hmm. And the further we get from where the money starts, the smaller our profit margin gets. Mm-hmm. And so we really are trying to bring ourselves back up to the top and work more directly in projects that make sense. And because each time everybody's taking a cut and is leaving less and less for...
You want to be a little higher on the food chain.
For Masca, we really are designed to help an aligned group of entities, starting from municipalities. We offer services to municipalities, helping them coming up with innovative ways, helping them redo their policies so that those hidden landmines that they're not aware of, that are preventing development from taking place, can be removed. And we offer our services to them on a contracted basis. General contractors and developers. We work for them when they have outreach diversity requirements to go out into the community and find contractors to work on their project. We go out and provide that services and do the marketing and hold pre-bid conferences and bring contractors in for them. And then we primarily work for our diversity contractors who we provide day-to-day back office support, managerial support, helping them do estimates, take off, all of those types of things. And within that, all of those people have a relationship with each other. That's the uniqueness of our model is that the municipality we're working for also has the general contractor working for them, which then has our subcontractor working for them. In the ideal world, we're in a controlled environment working for all of them. And then we bring in our nonprofit partners who gives loans and support to those small contractors. And then we run this model around and around and around.
Among the questions you are responding to or answering, the statements you're responding to, is a statement we've heard too often, we can't find none. What do I mean? What do you mean, Al McFarlane? Well, so the story is that as often as not, even when companies or municipalities or agencies say they are committed to the idea of opening up their supplier base of creating and providing more opportunity to make that not just the old boy network, but to look at other people that are providing goods and services, and they make grandiloquent proclamations about, you know, their commitment to diversity and to inclusion. But if you examine the bottom line, they'll say, yeah, well, that's our idea, that's our thought and our intent, but when we look, we can't find none. We can't find, or they say we can't find qualified, right? So these are both, in my view, rogue and bogus excuses, but business is fraught with reasons why things can't happen, and business has to always be able to dismantle barriers like that. Is that an assessment that makes sense to you?
It is. You know, what we found is that we call them pain points. Everybody's got them, right? Everybody's ready to think about the pain points that the minority contractor has, but they don't think about the pain points that the others have, right? And when you start talking about these municipalities, their number one pain point that we found is that nobody believes that their program are open and fair and accessible. I mean, that's just a given. So when they're talking, they're talking...
And they don't believe it because there's a record.
Because there's a record of it. Yeah. Well, and what we found is that...
Because they couldn't find none, right?
We've operated in both the regulated environment and the non-regulated environment. And the paperwork requirements to go and have somebody look out for you and protect you and make sure that you get in is prohibitive to you getting in to start with. I mean, they kill you with paperwork. And so when you start with the application to say that you're a minority is a 12-page, I mean, like, how hard can it be to say that I'm a minority? But it's a 12-page process that is actually tougher than going and saying that I'm poor being Section 3. I mean, so those kinds of things then give them with the position of, well, we got all this program, but nobody's coming. And from us is saying, well, you're creating barriers when you're supposed to be opening up avenues. And so we start from assuming that if they knew better, they would do better. And so we attempt to go and explain to them, okay, look, this is what's going on. But the truth of the matter is that the solution has to come from us. And that has been our number one issue is one of, okay, we know why you guys are doing a bad job because you're not the one who can come up with the solution. So when we come up with the solution and bring it to you, it is your job to support it. And once again, that's where someone like NDC is important for us because as we've been testing this model, we come to this knowing fully who we are. And when we're coming to the table and saying to everybody, look, we have a solution on how this can work, the first thing they're going to ask us is, who are you, right? And what have you done before? And we can give a whole list of things that we've done before, but since this has never been done before, we can't say we've done this before. So what did we do? We went and did it. We went in, did the project, and put our model together, and brought contractors together, and shared services, and went after projects, and did the projects, found partners, got them the loan money, paid the money back. So now when we go back to those municipalities, which is what we're doing right now, we're saying, remember when we talked to you 3 years ago, and we told you we had a plan, and you kept asking us, what have we done when we were brand new and you knew nobody had done it before? Why are you at? Now we should say we've actually done it. And so they are under even more pressure because they wasted all this time trying to figure out what's going on. Still don't know. And we're needing solutions. And so we're pushing the envelope by saying we have the solution. We'll tell you how it should work. We don't care about your preset programs, right? Tell us if you got something better, let's see it. And so there is a lot of frustration that these folks do a lot of talking and don't give and don't have a lot of results. We see that, but we're very confident that as we continue to move forward, that they will get in alignment because nothing they have is working and what we have is working. And so that's kind of where we, you know, in terms of
Phillip Porter, NDC, 20 years in the business, and what you've done is created a pathway for businesses, entrepreneurs, to both get in the business and sustain themselves. Mm-hmm. What does NDC do?
Well, what NDC do is we help a lot of small businesses. I mean, that's what we do. That's what Mike Tamale, our founder of the Neighborhood Development Center, that's what it was all founded on, helping disadvantaged businesses who really is not going to get the help anyplace else, whether it's at a bank or other type of institutions. That's what NDC has been known for the past 20 years. And when I say help, I actually mean, like you said, teaching them how to fish, right? And when we say that, we mean we have entrepreneurship training classes. So when they're done, they actually have a business plan that they can actually go to a bank or institution to actually apply for funding. But we just don't leave it there. We have relationship with law firms, so if they need legal assistance, NDC will be the intermediary in that, making that happen as well. Technical assistance, what we call technical assistance, is all of those tools and resources that a business needs to succeed. Whether it's bookkeeping, whether it's website development, whether it's brand awareness, whether it's marketing, whatever that is, we provide that assistance to the business owner. So we say once you're in with NDC, you're in it for life if you want to, so as your business grows. So we don't just stop working with you just because you finish a class or just because you hire 5 employees and now you. So we help you as long as you need the help. We provide loan servicing as well. Our loan program is designed long-term to make you, many of our clients who can't get monies from a bank, for a host of reasons, you know, credit, you know, collateral, all of that, but that's the market NDC loves. We love that marketplace. And our goal is long-term is make them to the point where they don't have to come to NDC for lending, right? They can go to any institution in the country and get the financial need, lending that they need. So our whole model is actually teaching them how to run and manage their own business. And hopefully if we teach them, they can teach their kids and pass that on to the next generation. Because I like to tell my students, you know, what you learn, don't keep it to yourself, mm-hmm. right? Pass it down, pass it down. And if you want to invite your kids to come to the class, you can come and sit into my class, right? So that's very, very, very important for us to do. But that's a little bit about the NDC.
We'll continue in a minute. I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. My guest, Phillip Porter at Neighborhood Development Center, NDC, and Silas Houston at MASCA. Stay tuned. I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarlane, broadcasting from the Marcus Garvey House in North Minneapolis. An important conversation about business, business development, business access, the challenges, the problems, and the opportunity. My guests are Phillip Porter, who's a loan officer with NDC. NDC is the Neighborhood Development Center in St. Paul. They serve the entire metro area. Mm-hmm. And Silas Houston, who is the CEO of a project, a business called MASCA. MASCA is Metro Area Small Contractors Alliance. And so, you know, two things, Phillip, in the 20 years, mm-hmm. what have you discovered to be the ongoing, persistent, maybe somehow seemingly intractable challenges for black people, minorities getting into business? What have been the greatest barriers?
Well, the greatest barriers, if you look at it from a high perspective, we do work with a lot of first-generation business owners. Okay. And as a result of that, they don't have a lot of history of actually running and operating a business. They have very good technical skills, so they might be an excellent chef, mm-hmm. or they might be a master barber, or they might be a good plumber and contractor. But some of the weakness that we've seen is on the business side of the ledger. And our goal is to help with that process, because they just lack the information. It's not that, and that's the only thing that they really lacked is the information.
So we're talking about black businesses and minority businesses, but mm-hmm. Somebody listening, watching might say, well, you know, who gives white businesses a break? Mm-hmm. How come we need special assistance when this is a nation that is entrepreneurial and small businesses really drive this economy, mm-hmm. Where do they get their break from? And why do we need anything special or different? Is that something you hear? Is that an argument that's worth talking about?
Well, that's thing that you hear, but the white businesses need assistance too.
Okay.
All right, so
The question is, mm-hmm. the white businesses get assistance.
But they get assistance.
That's the issue.
They get assistance.
And black businesses haven't.
Right.
Okay.
And the truth is, you know, there need to be more African-American in decision-making positions that's willing to take the time to go into our community and make that plea and actually offer that help.
And so when we say white businesses get the business, they get the support they need, mm-hmm. I think what comes to mind is our federal response to the need to promote entrepreneurship by creating legislation mm-hmm. and establishing something like the Small Business Administration, right?
Sure, yes.
It's a global response mm-hmm. to ensure the vitality and the health of small businesses mm-hmm. and to grow them. And so the question is, have we been able to have access to that same set of resources or have parallel, you know, strategies and resources that are targeted to our experience? What do you think?
Yeah, we have access, but Silas actually really touched on it when he said you can have access, but you can't fill out the documentation to actually get the loan. I mean, it's not an easy process to go through. All right, and a lot of us, we may give up on the process, but they don't know that this is the process even though sometimes they say, well, why are you treating me this way? Well, you have to understand, because many of them, this is the first time them going through, say, for instance, the lending process. Okay,
Let me be the devil's advocate here. This might be a little funny, it might not be. I just remember one of Eddie Murphy's Saturday Night Live routines. You may remember this one too. Eddie Murphy walks into the bank and wants a loan for his small business, right?
So
the banker looks at him and says, you know, Eddie, black, banker's white, we don't have any money, you know, period. You know, no application, no nothing, right?
Yeah.
And then either somebody else comes in, white guy comes in, I want money, open the drawer, take what you need. Take what you need. And the point I'm making is that there are relationships. You talked about whether we can fill the forms out.
Sure.
When the question is, are the forms often intentional barriers to preclude our engagement and access to the resource? I don't think that's always the case, but I know that there is a case of people making deals on a handshake,
a
wink and a nod, and business going on down the road. Is that opportunity available, accessible to us? Is it a good thing? I don't know.
Well, you know, I would interject and say this is that coming at it from a slightly different angle. I think when you look at investment and who is making the investment and who's deciding who gets invested in and who doesn't, when you look at who that is, it's rarely us. Even though a lot of time it's our money that's being invested. So we have the average African-American investor, right, investing in 401ks and all of their retirement plan, and those dollars are being given and accumulated and put into the hands of someone.
Fund manager.
Right, who never invested in our community.
Right.
Right, and so now when we go and look and say, okay, what is our willingness to stop giving the money to them and invest it directly in our community? And are we willing to then wait the 20, 30 years to get the return that we wait when they have it? And so when we start saying, why is no one investing in our community? Then we gotta ask ourselves, why aren't we investing in our community? And why do we continue to give our money to people who don't invest in our community? Because it's our money and we give it, and for the folks who work jobs in corporations, they give it every paycheck, right? None of it comes to us. None of it comes into our community. So part of what we're looking at from MASCA, when we say self-determination and self-investment, we're not just talking about our contract, we're talking about our community, those folks who we can build enough confidence in, who says, you know what, instead of giving them the money and waiting for them to give it back, I'll give it to you, and I'll wait for you to give it back, and I'll trust you with it, and I'll give you part of my check every 2 weeks for the next 15 years and wait another 15 to get it. If we had that kind of investment in ourselves, we wouldn't be having this discussion about where would the money come from and why can't we grow and why is there no development in our community. So I ask every person who I run into, and we've had this conversation before, Al, which is, hey, if we're not going to invest in our community, why are we surprised that they won't either, right? And so being someone who here in the community has made my stake here, make my living here, right, I have to come back to, not to them, but to us, and ask that question of why are we surprised they won't when we won't?
Other part of that, though, is how do we also, if the system's in place for making those sort of automatic investments through 401ks, how do we leverage the decision making of those institutions? How do we tell them, you gotta do so much of your investment in black businesses? Is that a strategy that makes sense or not?
I mean, not to me,
okay.
Because I think, stop giving it to them. That's the answer, don't give it to them.
And for me, it's also, it's a two-way, you know, two things have to work in any of these situations. The African-American business owner, there's things that they have to do. And many things they have to do, it's been my experience, is we've never shared with them, for example, that they need to have a decent credit score. Many of them, the first conversations they're having about credit is when they come and talk to us. Now, you go to a bank, they won't necessarily take that time to have that discussion. So it's not like their mom or their dad is actually sitting down at a family reunion and talking about credit, all right? I mean, so there's things that they have to do. And so that banker, and even in that situation, he knows just in a general sense, when an African-American walk in a general sense, they're gonna have less, they're gonna have lower credit, they're gonna have these all of these other issues. But if you had, you know, people that was more sensitive to those needs, it's not like the white is any better than the black, it's just that we have had some less exposure. No one has sit down and told me, because once I tell my clients that, okay, this is what you need to do, it gets taken care of, right? So it's for me, a lot of times the barrier is just not, it's just not knowing, not being aware or anything. And we say once they know better, what? They do better, then all of a sudden, then that gets...
Okay, but the answer on that still, yes and no. Now, Silas, you and I have talked about a success that you're having that is also a problem. And your organization has created some contract business for your contractors through a union shop, right? And so there's a question of how people are being paid. And what you discovered in connecting, hooking your team up to this work is that there was a differential, and money that should have been coming to those businesses or those individuals was being taken for a service that was not being provided to them. Tell me that story, because I want to. my point in asking this is that even when we think we're on the right track, there are structural systems and processes that will disadvantage us and that we are expected to not challenge. And as individuals, we typically don't, because, you know, we don't know. And then we fear retribution if we raise our voice. So tell the story, first of all.
You know, we're working on a project.
And you're welcome to name names if you want to.
I'll limitedly name names.
Okay.
We're working on a project in the city of St. Paul. The project has what they call a project labor agreement, which is a relationship with the union saying that even though the general contractor slash developer is not union, but for this one project they will be. So they'll sign a kind of a temporary agreement to be union so that diversity contractors, Section 3 contractors, can participate on the project without them having to become permanently union. Okay. And that's the basics of it. And in that sense, it makes...
So the one who won the contract, the general, is a shop that somebody owns and he's not a union shop.
Exactly.
In general.
In that general, right. But, so he's not a union shop.
But the requirement of getting this job, which is a public job, is you gotta be union.
Not necessarily that. It was a voluntary thing for them to decide to be union because of how they wanted to get the project done. Okay. And so you don't necessarily have, but then once there is a project that is over $250,000 and the city's money's into it, and there's a union contractor, they have to put a PLA in place so that these non-union people can participate. PLA. If we're talking a project labor agreement, okay. So if we're talking a total union environment, that means there is no PLA. So the PLA purpose is to allow non-union contractors to participate on this one project basis. Mm-hmm. What happened was is that we come into the project aware of that, talk to them explicitly about, okay, our guys are coming, they're gonna bring their current staff, their current crew with them, right? And with that, their crew, they gotta be able to bring their current crew with them to work on the project. They said, okay, no problem. Well, when we get there, they say, your current crew has now gotta join the union, pay into the union funds, and we're like, whoa, hold on a minute. They're not union contractors, and why would they pay into your fund? And they said, well, you signed the PLA, that means they must join. And I'm like, joining a union is always voluntary. You can't make anybody join. But our issue with it was that it required a payment into the union's pension fund that has a multi-year vesting period for someone who's only gonna be in there at best 4 months, maybe, for the duration of that project. And then they were talking $8.63 an hour, which is like, that's more than minimum wage that they would be given away and would never get anything for, because they would never vest because they're not union and they're not intending to be union. Right. Well, we thought if we just explain that,
they'd understand,
right. And that would be the end of it. And instead, what we found out is that the way that this thing is structured, I mean, if you follow it through, to expect a small diversity contractor to sort this out on their own, you start off with an 86-page agreement with the general contractor. Within that is a one-page letter of assent that refers to a 9-page project labor agreement, which is not in the agreement, but refers to, which that agreement then refers to a 300-page union document. And they're saying that because this guy signed this agreement in this one piece of paper, that he should understand all of that and known that he's now committed his workers to give up their money. And I'm like, whoa, in what world can he sign and make me responsible, right? So maybe the contractor signed, but the worker hasn't signed anything. What have you explained to them? What have you told them? The general position was one of, this is what we always do. This has been going on, and who are you to question us? And so that became a bone of contention, not because we were wrong, but because we had the nerve to question. And when we had details and information to back up what we were saying, their response was, I don't have to say it in writing. When I call you on the phone and say it to you, just do what I say, which made no sense to us whatsoever. I mean, so we heard from city officials, we heard from attorneys, we heard from all sorts of people. Nobody's willing to put their position in paper on writing. Even as we're sitting here now, the issue is unresolved. They haven't said definitively what gives them the right to force these workers to give up this money. We're the first people ever.
Will not be vested.
Never be vested.
Yeah, and they'll never get their. And
they say they've been doing this in Minneapolis and in St. Paul for years, and we are the first people to refuse to pay. Mm-hmm. So that means that there's been any number of past low-income minority workers
left
who have worked under a PLA, signed a union agreement, had them take their money, and given them nothing in return for it. The good news is that because this is pension funds, they got a record of everybody's money they took.
Right.
Right? They got to.
Right. So at some point in time, there's a liability issue here.
Well, and that's where, so we're not here to try to make that kind of fight. What we're here to say is that
On our deal. We don't want to pay.
We're not going to pay, but we're here more so to say that the reason why we were able to discern this when others could not is because we have a group of professionals who this is what they do, right? This is their trade. They're not, they know nothing about painting, but they know everything about an AIA contract, right? They know nothing, right? And so when we bring those things together, then it makes it possible for us to have this story to tell to you when it's been happening to hundreds of people, but we're the one who can tell the story because our model brings that level of protection, brings that level of oversight, because it's that day-to-day thing that allows us to stay out of trouble when we know that trouble is out there waiting for us.
I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane, my guest, Phillip Porter from Neighborhood Development Center, and Silas Houston, MASCA. MASCA is Metro Area Small Contractors Alliance. We're talking about business development, entrepreneurship, how to make it happen. I want to talk about how do we work together to create this identity in the Black community so that we see ourselves as entrepreneurial people. We'll come back in a minute. Come back. McFarlane, welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarlane, broadcasting from the Marcus Garvey House in North Minneapolis. My guests, my friends, Phillip Porter is with Neighborhood Development Center in DC. He's a loan officer and business advisor. Also, Silas Houston, who's the principal, the CEO of MASCA. MASCA is Metro Area Small Contractors Alliance. And this is a great conversation. At the end of the day, I'm interested in what we together and collectively can do to change the picture, the vision of who we are. I envision us as entrepreneurial people. I'd like to see our people looked at and looking at each other, walking down the street, and somebody says, "Oh, those people, they're yes. business people."
Yes.
How do we do that? Is that a desirable, is that a possibility? Silas, what do you think?
Mm-hmm. I think it is. I mean, I think that for us, it's we're actualizing that through MASCA. And when I look at what it is that we could be doing is every allowance that we would like someone else to give to us in terms of being willing to invest or being willing to help, then we should be willing to give to each other, right? And so if we want to lower the paperwork requirements for getting to money, if we had our own money, then we could make the requirements be whatever it is that we want it to be. So I think that we have to really accept the notion of we are our own solution and that nobody else is coming to save us, and that every time we think of what needs to happen, then we need to think about what we are going to do
to make it happen.
If MASCA had 1,000 African-American investors that just gave it $30 a week for 5 years, right? And then said we'd wait another 5 years to get it back. I mean, we wouldn't be having a capitalization issue. We wouldn't be having a capitalization question. We wouldn't be talking about what somebody else needed to do for us. We would be talking about what we ourselves can do. And then we can look at the young folks in our community who are ready and able to work, but their starting point is less productive starting point than other people. That's just the starting point. But if we're not willing to make that allowance to bring them up to a level of true productivity, then we shouldn't be surprised that nobody else is either. And so I believe through self-investment, I believe through shared resource model between us coming together collectively, deciding clearly that it makes more sense for us to work together than to compete against each other and go and compete with others, I think that the sky's the limit on what we could accomplish, and we would never have to go to a bank or an institution or whatever. The reality is that we have a confidence issue in each other. We don't really have a lot of confidence. People say trust. To me, that doesn't really cut. Confidence precedes action. And so we need to build confidence in each other so that we can then feel comfortable giving our resources to each other, feel comfortable with somebody looking like us, controlling those resources, and feel comfortable saying to whoever else is not in alignment with us, we don't care what your beliefs and your position is, we are investing in us for our betterment. Mm-hmm. That's never exclusionary, but it doesn't include everybody. And that's the part that we have to.
So Phillip, what do you think? What's the vision for you?
Well, and I agree as well, and which is one reason why NDC is part of the MASCA project. And we figure at NDC, if we stay in our lane, right? And our lane is whether it's lending or whether it's providing that support or whether it's providing that entrepreneur or that contractor with some pro bono legal services, whatever tools that we can provide, that's what we like to provide to the process. And so we understand that collectively and collaboratively, it benefits everyone. But ultimately, it's gotta be in the best interest of the business owner. And then to add on top of that, for insight and for you, to really promote those outcomes and those results. So when MASCA does this job, he's got 3 or 4 contractors on a major project in St. Paul. When the project is done, maybe we should interview all of the African Americans that was involved in it, all the employees, MASCA, the contractors, and say, this is what was actually done. Mm-hmm. We're actually doing some positive thing. Now let's repeat that.
Tell the story.
Mm-hmm. You know, we need to really tell that story within our community that there are some positive things, but we really need to tell the story. But the story has to be with the entrepreneur up front. Mm-hmm. The story don't have to be about NDC, it's about the entrepreneur who actually was actually in there doing the work.
So what do you think is going to happen? I have this thought that where we are right now in Twin Cities with the tension in North Minneapolis over the shooting death, the police shooting of a man, there are other issues like that around Twin Cities about equality, about disparities in health and in income. For example, the data reports indicate a loss of income, a loss of wealth in the black community in the past several years. We're losing money. Nobody else lost money. We lost money. Minnesota is a rich state, a healthy state. Unemployment as low as 3-point-something percent for the state in general. At the same time, in this neighborhood, North Minneapolis, unemployment at 16% or higher. And so these disparities exist across the spectrum. What are we going to do about that? I'm thinking that there's enough attention being brought to the pervasive and consistent and perennial existence of these problems that those who have been presented and present themselves as our friends but who've managed our misery and got the money managing it, somebody gotta be accountable. And I think that where we are now is that this is a breakthrough moment for the black community. The misery, the pain is such that something's gotta happen. Something's gotta happen. And the what's gotta happen is the capacity of our people to step up and take charge of providing solutions for our people. What do you think?
Agree with you 100%. Mascot is actually doing that. And to your point, I mean, these are livable, these are very good wages, you know, that's being paid to African Americans in that area, in that field. And so we need to continue with that. We need to capitalize that, but we actually need to grow it. And the faster we can grow it, the better. You know, the various relationships, because if you have a model, okay, if you did it with four contractors that we're working with, well, next year, maybe we should be doing it with two dozen, because we know we have the model that works. We got some resources there that works. But like I said, we do want to control that. But this is actual something that we can actually say that X amount of people was working on a job, was getting this kind of money. Now, how can we take that and replicate it, but replicate it quickly, right? And replicate it quickly, because we don't have time to waste on this. We just don't. We need to replicate it very, very quickly. So the model was there, and more of those partners, you know, like NDC or whatever in the community, because it takes us all, it's gonna take us all to do, you know, MASCA doing what they do, we doing what they do, the media doing what they do.
You talked about it takes a village, and you got a take on that, Silas. What is the take?
You know, when I say, when we think of village, we think of in our name, alignment. That's what that's what a village to us is a group of aligned entity that are in close proximity that do business in a way that is good for the collective. And that's when we say it takes a village, that's what we mean. And so when we look at the village that's here, right, there's obviously the diversity contractors who need to come together and work together. There's the nonprofit entities such as MEDA and NDC and folks like that who have resources. But then there's that philanthropic slash investment community that have dollars and resources to put into something that says they want to see growth and development within the community. But then there's also those developers and nonprofit developers and for-profit developers who have projects that they're doing within the city, within the neighborhood, that they need people to work on. And then the people who we really are talking about is those low-income workers from within that community who can be tapped into, working for these diversity contractors who get support from the nonprofit developers, investment from the philanthropic community, and work consistently for the nonprofit developers and other developers that are working within the city. We've mapped that whole thing out.
We'll put it on the screen. We'll walk through that. It'll be on the screen.
It basically describes where there's a role for each. What we think of as inputs. Everybody who puts something in gets something out, right? So the investor puts their money in, but they get a return on their investment, but they also get development within the community, jobs created. You have the nonprofit economic development agencies who gets an increased utilization of their services, more loans given. They get utilization of their resources.
They meet their goals.
Yeah. And they get jobs created, mm-hmm. right? For the worker, what they get is construction is, for a lot of people in their mind, a part-time job because I go work on a project, I get laid off, I don't know when I'm gonna get hired again. And so what we're looking to do is to create a model where we have predictable and projects laid out mm-hmm. through our partnerships on a project-by-project basis. So someone starting to work knows I'm not only gonna work on this project, I'm gonna go work on the one after and the one after. And through that, we can get them transferable skills, we can move them towards being a journeyman, and we can get a reduction of poverty, a increase of wealth, of transference of skills. And everybody within the model has a reason to maintain the model because they're getting something out of it. With that, we can then create livable wage jobs where people are working right here within the community. We can create consistent work opportunities where they can go from being I don't know nothing to being a journeyman, to being a superintendent, to owning their own company. And we can do all of that without really even having to venture outside of the community for the work. Nonprofit developers in Minneapolis and St. Paul do hundreds of residential rehabs, building of new houses. You have developers and general contractors that work on projects that get major funding from City of Minneapolis and St. Paul that are doing projects that can utilize this model, make a relationship with these guys as opposed to hiring them on a project. And through that, we can begin to grow a local workforce and have them be supported through local opportunities. That is all possible because of the alignment of individuals and because we're not asking anybody to do something just to do it, right?
So what are the barriers then to moving forward on this? Where will the resistance be?
People are used to doing what they're doing. Mm-hmm. People are not ready for somebody who looks like us to come and tell them we got a better way. I mean, I'm just being honest about it, right? And that really is the barrier because they're getting horrible results. So we're not asking somebody who's doing something great that's working to change it, mm-hmm. right? And so
explore that. It means they're getting horrible results. What do you mean?
Meaning that
if their goal is to do this amount in diversity, the reality is the results at this point are horrific.
They're horrific. And for us, development is the word.
But the problem is that the structure gives them a pass. They say good faith effort, and mm-hmm. they can say to the reporting authority, I tried. The problem with that is that if they don't achieve the goal, say in construction, for example, if it's $100 million worth of business and the goal is 35% going to businesses of color, right? And they end up getting 10% participation, not 35% participation, that means our community is leaving $25 million mm-hmm. that we're supposed to get, mm-hmm. that the regulations require be awarded to our community, but there has been a willingness to say, wink, wink, mm-hmm. we tried, did we really? And the reality is, how do we get to where we say, you know what? Oh, hell no. That's my money, and I want my money. What do you think?
Well, I think that the reason why MASC is doing what we're doing is so that we can take away all of their excuses mm-hmm. for not doing major business with us. And then we can say exactly what you're saying. Hey, where's our money, right? Because, hey, we got the structure, we got the know-how, we have the financing, right? We have the insurance, we have the equipment, we have the capitalization, the working capital. So why are you not giving us this opportunity? Whereas the other thing is that they say disadvantage, and then they expect us to be the cheapest. If we could be the cheapest, how are we disadvantaged?
Right.
Right, and so we have to take away that notion of, oh, you can't be the cheapest, so there's something wrong. Well, you said we was disadvantaged, which means that we cannot be the cheapest.
Yeah, right.
Right. Give us a chance to shake that status, mm-hmm. and we can be the cheapest. Right now, we can be value-added, and we can add things that no one else can because we bring that minority worker to the job site. We bring that training aspect of them. We bring that growth aspect there. What we cannot do is right now be the cheapest. And that's a discussion we begin to have. We've had it with MnDOT. We presented them with documents asking the question of, can a DBE succeed in a low bid environment? And the question is obviously they can't because they wouldn't be a DBE then. How am I disadvantaged? And so we have to get to some of those baseline understandings of, yeah, we got some things we need to do so that we can do business correctly, but you have some things that you need to change as well. Not business rules, but just basic common sense of, I can't ask him to compete with people and be the cheapest and say he's disadvantaged at the same time. Why would we need these programs if the result of being disadvantaged does not make you unable to be the cheapest? Then you really have not been disadvantaged. Right? And so that's the part that our research showed more than anything is that the fault in the system is we say they're disadvantaged, but we ask them to be the cheapest. I mean, and they do it everywhere. And so our relationship is trying to build relationships that allow us to operate in a cost plus, not to exceed environment,
okay.
and not a low bid environment. It's doomed.
We're out of time. It goes so quickly, but Phillip yeah. Porter, NDC, Neighborhood Development Center, Silas, Houston, MASCA, Metro Area Small Contractors Alliance. Thank you both for what you do.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for being in this program. Mm-hmm. I think it's important that we try to shift the dialogue, change the narrative, both within the community, but also in the business community, so that the language we speak is the language that enables and empowers our people to be our best selves, to be entrepreneurial,
yes.
to be successful, to create wealth, and to add value to our society. Gentlemen, thank you so much.
Thank you.
I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. We'll see you next time.
Programming is supported by UCARE, where health coverage, personal service, and quality care come together to put members first. Learn more at ucare.org. UCARE, healthcare that starts with you.
Be up, be down, be clean, be messy, be here, be wherever, be sour, be sweet, be the rhythm, be the beat, be funny, be serious, be in, be out. Wherever you're at in life, be you. With Medica, you belong.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We want to thank Al McFarlane for bringing us all those great words and all our lovely guests, all the guests in the house. Everything's good, you know. So I want y'all to tune in every Tuesday morning right around 9 o'clock. Because we're going to play a song. All the guests will be home. We'll be feeling like talking, have a robust conversation. Cause this thing is safe, the message is clear. Everybody knows we gotta get the night.